So right off the bat, heading into this Minnesota Vikings versus New Orleans Saints game, I think there are several things that are very interesting to talk about. And let's just jump into the first one that you'll see on this play. And this is something that I'm going to be a little bit concerned about with the Vikings heading into this game is I feel like at times they get a little bit too cute. And what I mean by that is something like this, where it's going to be play action and they're going to have Adam Thielen run that route right there. This part is pretty simple. It's something you see get done pretty frequently again in a goal line situation, or at least an inside the five situation like it is here. And so that's what they're doing. This part I have no problem with. This is the play I like. This is the play that can work out, especially when you have a good receiver like Thielen. And so that's why they're doing it. And after the ball is snapped, it is in a pretty solid situation. I mean, there is a Green Bay linebacker who is in front of Adam Thielen, but without a doubt, Thielen could potentially get open if he gets past him. So it's a pretty decent situation. Kirk Cousins is going to look in that direction and see if he gets open. However, they're doing something a little bit different on this play. Instead of it being what I showed you on paper, Thielen is actually going to cut back to the bottom half of the screen, but now he's just not open and there's nothing Cousins can do. That's kind of the thing where they basically just outsmarted themselves. Where it's actually not a terrible play call in a vacuum. I mean, run a play that's similar to a play you see run pretty frequently, so that way teams will be expecting it, but then have a slight twist so that way you can fool them. I mean, that part I get, that part makes total sense to me. However, in this particular situation, that just wasn't the smart decision to make. And I mean, sometimes there is some logic behind doing that, but there is a reason why those play calls that always seem to get called always seem to get called. It's because they work a good percentage of the time. And again, this one play in a vacuum is no big deal, but I do feel like this is a small thing that I have noticed with the Vikings that they're going to have to make sure they don't do against the Saints because they're just going to have to make sure they maximize their players' potential and give them a chance. That being said, the Minnesota Vikings absolutely can have some very significant plays against the Saints. And one thing they could really do a very good job of is a play like this, where it's going to be cover two zone that the Seattle Seahawks are in. And first things first, they're going to have their tight end and their halfback run those two routes right there. So this is a pretty good idea because essentially what it's going to do is that there's only one Seahawk who is playing zone in that area, so he kind of has multiple options. He could run further in to make sure he's covering up the halfback, but that would leave the tight end open deep. He also could stay deep, but now he's leaving the halfback open. So that's the way this play is going to work. Pretty simple concept. And also just one slight thing that will come into play is there is a receiver running a go route on the top half of the screen. But anyways, take a look back at the bottom half of the screen, or not bottom half of the screen, but a little bit lower down, and look at what's going on right over there. As you see, the Seattle defender made sure he took away the shallow part of the field, meaning that there is a tight end who is completely wide open. He absolutely could make a catch here, and so a Seattle safety is saying, wait, we can't let that happen. There's a player wide open. I gotta run in and make sure I cover that up, because otherwise they can easily get the first down here. However, that's just a mistake, because now there's going to be a Viking who is completely wide open deep down the field, and Cousins is going to be able to run outside the pocket, hit him, and they get a touchdown just like that. It was a mistake by Seattle for sure, no question about that, but at the same time, you do have to give the Vikings credit because they all ran their routes pretty well. I think sometimes people forget just how much of a team game a wide receiver core is. I think that's something that kind of goes underlooked. A lot of people, maybe some casual fans, might think that it's just basically a bunch of one-on-one situations, but oftentimes, especially going up against zone coverage, it really is about how well can everybody run their route, not just how well can one guy run their route. I think a lot of people don't take into consideration how much it can really help a receiver having other good receivers on their team. And I do feel like the Vikings, you know, having Diggs and Thielen, obviously, the two main guys, that can really help them a lot. But of course, that being said, oftentimes it does come down to one-on-one matchups as well, especially in man. And when that happens, sometimes you're going to need to beat an opposing team's best corner. And that's unfortunate for Minnesota because they're going up against the Saints, who have Marshawn Lattimore, who's been one of the better corners in the past couple of years. He kind of, he had a sort of a down year in his second season. I believe his catch percentage was about like 53% his first year. It jumped up to about 63% his second, but then it went back down to 52% this year. So he's definitely having a much better third season. He's returned to his rookie form, so to speak. And so anyways, let's just talk about what he does well. So one thing that's actually very unique is he kind of gives the impression that a player could get open. And what I mean by that is a play like this, where it's a one-on-one matchup right over there, and the receiver is running a go route. So this seems like it could be something where it's like, okay, if he gets open, maybe let's throw it in that direction. And as you see, after the ball is snapped and Minshew does make the throw, there definitely is a window and there appears to be some separation. And so you would think, okay, this absolutely could be a catch. Now, Minshew underthrows it, so it wasn't a perfect throw, but it kind of gives you an idea of like, okay, well, Kirk Cousins is pretty good. Kirk Cousins can make some perfect throws. Maybe you could gain some yards that way. It could potentially, at least if nothing else, be worth a shot. However, that doesn't necessarily mean that he actually was open just because it looked like he was open. And I think that there's honestly no better example of showing that than a play that actually happened with the Vikings. This was not this season, but this was in 2018. But since it's what I'm talking about, I'm still going to bring it up, even though obviously the teams were different then. They weren't totally different, and I'm really only talking about Lattimore here, so it still works. But basically what I want you to take a look at is that right over there, once again, similar idea. Press coverage, it's going to be a one-on-one matchup. This time it's Treadwell running a go route down the sideline. So this is the kind of thing that makes you say, okay, well, again, if he's open, maybe we can try to fit it through that tight window. And that's what's going to kind of happen. I mean, look at what Lattimore does on his first step. He's kind of just letting him give up that first step, essentially. Lattimore is saying, you can have that first step. I trust myself that I'm quick enough that I'm not going to get burned too badly if you get by me. So go ahead, take that first step. It seems like it's a pretty risky move because, I mean, if you look now, there, again, some separation. If Cousins can perfectly throw this ball over Lattimore, this could be a completion. And Cousins is going to perfectly throw this ball, but Lattimore's able to finally get his head turned around and still find a way to knock that ball out. He's one of the only guys in the business that I see doing that where that late into a play can still get his head turned around and can still find a way to make a play on the ball. And that's kind of what makes him such a frustrating corner to go against, is you think that you have a guy open, but then it turns out you actually don't. He kind of gives that illusion of there being someone open. He's like a mirage, you know. You think that you have an opening, but then you don't, and it results in a lot of pass deflections and sometimes interceptions as well. Now, that's not to say, though, that there isn't a way to beat Lattimore. I mean, let's take a look back at that first Jaguars game. It's going to be a cover two man right now. So Lattimore, he has basically no help since the route he's going up against is that route right there. This is going to be all up to, can he find a way to beat this route? First things first, what's going to happen is Lattimore is going to just run up and he's going to create some contact. But for the Jaguar receiver right there, DJ Chark, he's kind of just saying, you know what, fine, apply some contact. You're not going to be able to tackle me because that's a penalty. So you can apply whatever contact you want. I'm still just going to work on getting by you because I know I am not bigger than you, but I think I can be at least as fast as you. And so that's why I'm going to try to just say, you know what, I'm not even going to worry about the press part. I'm going to get around you. And so that's what he does. And again, similar situation where there is some separation, but because Lattimore can finish so well, he can easily run over and knock the ball away. So maybe not the best situation for Jacksonville right now, but again, there is some separation. However, there is one thing that is very interesting about this play. Once again, I lied to you. The route I showed you on the screen is not the route that he's going to be running. He cuts back, and just with that one step, now there's way more separation. So, you know, Lattimore is the kind of guy who can get beat like that. You can't really necessarily just beat him straight up, but you can outsmart him, and that's a huge part of football, especially with receivers going up against corners, is trying to get them to think you're doing one thing and do another. And as I showed you with that first play about the Vikings, you might have even been a little bit wondering why I even brought that play up. This is why I brought that play up, because while the Vikings sometimes get a little bit too cute with it and, you know, do those types of things that they don't necessarily have to do, against the Saints and especially against Lattimore, it might be worth it to try to get a little cute sometimes. Now, all that being said, Minshew actually misses the throw and it results in an interception. So again, my example of Lattimore getting beat is him still ending up with an interception, which kind of still goes to show the talent you're going up against. But if you do decide you want to attack Lattimore to some degree, that is the way you attack Lattimore. It's not just trying to put your number one receiver out there and hope he can beat him straight up, because very few guys, honestly, maybe nobody can beat him straight up. But you can outsmart him just like you can outsmart anybody. So maybe that's the thing you do if you decide to attack Lattimore. And also, there is one other superstar on that Saints defense that has to be talked about, and that is Cam Jordan. Cam Jordan is just a monster, and he's a huge part of that defense. Like, watch this play. It's going to be, actually, they're going to have a chip here. So the tight end is going to run out to chip Jordan, and then the tackle is going to make sure that he's the one who finishes off the block. So typically, when you have a chip, that tells you that you should be good. You shouldn't have to worry about that side of the field anymore. The downside, of course, is it sort of takes away an extra receiver, but the bright side is that you don't have to worry about Cam Jordan, so easily a good trade-off. And so Tennessee tight end does the chip, and now if you look at this situation, what's really unique here is watch how Cam Jordan, his left hand, is kind of holding on to his opposing tackle's right hand right there. this isn't going to allow a tackle to get good leverage. And because Jordan is so strong, he's able to just push him back. I mean, watch how far back he got pushed. I mean, even a guard realizes something's going on and is going to try to run to get into the play. But there's just nothing you can do at this point. Jordan is able to get to Tannehill and they get the sack. And so that's what you're going up against in terms of Cam Jordan. So this Saints defense is a very good defense. It's definitely going to be a challenge for the Minnesota Vikings and for Kirk Cousins. But at the same time, everyone keeps saying Kirk Cousins can't show up in a big game. Kirk Cousins can never win a big game. Well, I can't think of a much bigger game than this one, to be quite honest. I mean, Kirk Cousins absolutely has a chance. I mean, he really does. They're going to have to get creative. They'll probably have to get creative while chipping Cam Jordan a lot. But if they can do that, and if Kirk Cousins can play his best football, which we have seen him play very good football, then he can absolutely get some yards through the air. And if Dalvin Cook is back and back to 100%, they will get some yards through the ground game, even though the Saints' defensive line is very good. Obviously, Dalvin Cook is very good, so I could have made a whole other video about that as well, but I wanted to kind of focus just on Kirk Cousins going up against the defense, because I think that's really, I mean, that's the narrative right now. Maybe that's not the most interesting thing in terms of the game, but that is the narrative. It's Cousins can't play in a big game. Cousins will get you to the playoffs, but he won't do much once he gets there. Well, if you can go into New Orleans and win a playoff game, that narrative will die just like that. So, I mean, honestly, if I'm Kirk Cousins, I'm loving the situation that I'm going up against the Saints, but that's just me. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. There actually will be another video coming out about this game. It's going to be the Vikings defensive line going up against the Saints offensive line. That's why I didn't make it about the line play in terms of the Saints defensive line going up against the Vikings offensive line, because I wanted to save that type of video for the other side of the field, where I think it'll be a lot more interesting with a great Saints offensive line versus a great Vikings defensive line. That should be a lot of fun. Really looking forward to that. But yeah, I mean, that's just what I think of this game. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and as always, thanks for watching.